A lot of books. Yeah, I like a man with a lot of books.
How are you doing?
I'm doing well.
On this lovely summer day?
Couldn't be better. Yeah, I just, we've just been having opening weekend Q&As at the Lemley Royal for my film Vision Portraits. And so those have been going well. I've had a couple moderators for those. Uh-huh. And yeah, it's been nice.
And you're a New Yorker?
I'm a New Yorker, yeah. But yeah. I went to CalArts for my MFA. So I've spent some time out here.
You're used to our orangey ways.
Yes.
And the warm summers.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Better than Florida, at least.
Yeah.
It's not as sweaty.
No, it's nice and dry.
So are you, is this part of the process something that you enjoy? Is it something that you've kind of come to peace with over the years of being out selling the movie and getting the word out and all of that?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I guess I don't necessarily think of it as selling the movie as much as like the final round of making the movie. Like mm-hmm. I think of doing sit down interviews differently than I do like doing a Q&A with an audience member and then having them come up to me and cry because mm-hmm. the movie impacted them so much. I mean, I think that's just a beautiful experience to know that something that you made impacted someone in that way. Mm-hmm. And an experience that is, you know, increasingly hard to find in this era of streaming dominance and theaters slowly, slipping away.
Yeah. It's funny because I do a bunch of Q&As during the year and during the award season in particular. And
yeah.
there is a clear separation between the movies that are kind of the bigger movies where there's a celebrity element to it and that's yeah. what they're there for.
Right.
Versus movies, particularly documentaries, where it's very, in any audience, it can be 25 people, it can be 30 people in a small screening room.
Yeah.
Who there's almost always somebody who's finding a very personal connected part of the story for themselves.
Right. Yeah. And for me, it's always interesting to have the opportunity to talk to that person and why it connected with them in that specific way. And, and sometimes it can be like incredibly emotional and triggering and they actually need a hug. You know what I mean? So mm-hmm. I'm happy to provide that.
Yeah. Well, that seems to be your milieu in life. I mean, the art that you've done, the films that you've done, they all seem to be digging deeper, digging for something else.
Yeah. I mean, I think that they all, on some level, deal with outsiders, you know, that maybe mainstream society would think about as, like, marginalized or, you know, these niche communities that have something to say and that are pushing forward mm-hmm. to say it. I mean, I think that that's definitely been a kind of constant through line.
Do you see yourself yeah. as inherently niche in a way? I mean, do you see is your interest in the artistic work about the niche, or is that just the stories you find and the places where you find your passion?
Yeah, I think it's mostly where I find my passion. Yeah, and you know, I don't know. Sometimes it's less niche than people believe it is to be. You know what I mean? And I'm always happily surprised that is the case. So you know, for example, with Vision Portraits, I feel like, you know, there's this huge wide spectrum between the fully sighted and the fully blind that just doesn't get acknowledged. You know what I mean? That we all have different capacities in terms of vision and gradual vision loss as we age and people start to need reading glasses and
just becoming more and more of the story.
Yeah, you know what I mean?
Longer.
It's just not this like cut and dry binary thing, which I think, you know, is a way that a lot of people think about it. So for me, it's interesting just to think about where people fall on that spectrum and how to tell that story visually, and whether it's, you know, vision loss through something as common as like cataracts, right? Or like macular degeneration, or like whatever it is. Mm-hmm. It's like, it affects like millions of people who I think can gain a lot from the film. So even though the film deals with the experiences of blind and severely visually impaired artists, I don't think that that is just the audience for it. I think mm-hmm. that, like, I found that, you know, that it's a huge demographic, even just in terms of people that are just interested in art and creativity and those kinds of processes and what it takes for an artist to make something that they're really passionate about.
Well, it really struck me as like it being one kind of symptom in mm-hmm. the world.
Right.
And the thing you carry, I mean, I was very particularly struck with a dancer talking about how, you know, even though she has whatever sight she had, she was, when she closed her eyes and didn't see anything,
yeah,
she was doing better work.
Yeah.
Like it flowed through her differently.
Yeah, no. And that it's, you know, that's definitely true for her. I think she does her best at dancing when her eyes are closed and when she can give herself over to the power of the rhythm and where the rhythm is taking her body without thinking about the space necessarily or how she's looking to other people. It becomes an emotional, internal, rhythmic experience that she like thrives on and lives for.
Wasn't that the journey of an artist anyway, kind of, that you have to give up the idea of what people are looking at and how they're seeing what you do and just do what it is that you are thriving to do, needing to do?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I think for a lot of artists, for me, definitely, that is the place that I have to go to in order to get to what I think is the most powerful, truthful version of the film that I want to make.
And even like the photographer, I mean, having another visual artist in the film was interesting, and he, you know, he seems to feel like he's found something in this in a way that's maybe better than even when he had his, you know, when he had better sight.
Yeah, I think that, you know, I think that all of the artists in the film, you know, adjusted, you know, as their vision shifted. And I think that with John in particular, John Dugdale, the photographer in the film, he's such a kind of student of art history and of 19th century photographic processes, and, you know, saw so many of the great works of art before he lost his vision, that I think that all of that is within his body, and that's something that that, you know, we experience as viewers in ways that I won't give away, but that I think are really interesting for viewers to experience in a screen over black and coming up with their own images and seeing what a list of items can conjure in each different person in terms of like a specific image. And so I think of John as having a real vast art history archive in his body that he like literally calls on to make photographs. And I think sometimes it's just subconsciously there because he was a really incredible student of art history. And so, you know, those are the things that he utilizes when he's working with his assistants and posing subjects and thinking about shot composition and where things should be. And so I think all of that is within him. And so, you know, I think that that's something that he really wanted to convey to me, that there's, you know, so much more in your mind and in your heart for you to draw on for inspiration that's outside of what you take in with your eyes.
So I guess that begs the question for you as the filmmaker, who are also part of the film, how that journey is for you, whether there are things where you can see enough to perhaps frame something a certain way, mm-hmm. or whether there are times where you have a sense of it internally that is beyond or separate from what you are specifically what you're seeing in a situation.
Yeah. I mean, I think I do have a sense of it, like, emotionally, and, you know, what a scene is specifically conveying, right? And, like, what is the best way to shoot that scene, right? Is it, you know, is it from, behind a crack in a doorway where I'm just seeing the characters in silhouette and they're having a private moment that it feels almost like voyeuristic to be seeing? Mm-hmm. Or is it better to have it be a two-person walk and talk, like, up the street in the golden hour, right? You know, where people are talking about their relationship? Or, you know, is it better to shoot an interview in someone's house where they feel really comfortable, although that might not be the most visually stimulating environment? Maybe that's where they're gonna feel the safest,
right,
and the most willing to be vulnerable in front of the camera, and thus maybe that's the best place to shoot, because they're going to be talking about things that are, you know, challenging and intimate for them to talk about. So how do I create that environment for them to tell those stories?
So if you had 20/20 vision, you would be doing all that, making those decisions before you get to this spot where you have to frame a shot anyway, right?
Not necessarily.
No.
I mean, I think that I'm always a big believer in preparation, and then throwing the preparation away and living in the moment, but knowing that I did enough research to know the subject inside and out. And then, you know, my whole thing is, like, have a plan going in, and if the plan is good, you execute it. And if a better idea comes along while you're on set, then, like, why not try that out as well and see if it actually does work better? You know, why just limit yourself, right, to the parameters of your preparation?
So is that harder, or is it just a different kind of process in the moment? Is it harder to throw away the plan and improvise?
No, it's not harder. I mean, I think it's actually quite natural for me, mm-hmm. to, because a lot of times, you know, in both fiction and documentary, I don't necessarily have the opportunity to scout the location beforehand.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, sometimes I can, but sometimes not. And, right, you know, sometimes I have to, adapt the shot list to the way that the light is coming in the room, right?
Mm-hmm.
The skin color of the main character, mm-hmm. and what the character's wearing. And so I think all of those factors kind of come into play. But then I also tend to just collaborate with kick-ass DPs. So I don't feel like that's necessarily my main focus as a director.
Mm-hmm.
I think as a director, I tend to focus on emotion and on story, mm-hmm. and on character and how to elicit those powerful moments within a story. And so where do the actors need to be emotionally for a specific scene to resonate in the way that it needs to resonate given where it's taking place in the overall arc of the film, right? So like for me as a director, I have to walk around with the entire movie in my head, whether people are aware of that or not. That's part of my job, right? To know like how this little piece fits into that and sort of what happened before and what has affected this relationship up until that point and what is the coloring, the dynamic between these characters. And if the actors aren't there emotionally, what do I need to say to them in order to get them closer to where they need to be? So do I need to actually call cut and take one of the actors out into the hallway and give them separate direction away from the other actors so that they have their own adjustment that they're making to sort of get them closer to where they're going to be or to affect the other person in a different way or just, so I don't know. I think all of that is constantly fluid. And I think it also corresponds to documentary as well. It's sort of like, I would go in with a list of maybe 12 to 15 questions that I wanted to ask, but who knows what kinds of tangents that is gonna lead the person that I'm talking to onto, and are those more interesting tangents? Are they more emotionally powerful and resonant? And so then I absolutely get off the page and, and go down that path with them. And when is it so overpowering for them emotionally that they need a minute to cry and I need to just sit in silence and let them know that it's okay and that we can take as long as necessary for them to gain composure or stop for a little while and or have them continue and push through it if that's what they want to do, you know what I mean? But leaving them some choices and feeling empowered to tell their own story. So I don't know. I don't think that fiction and documentary are that different. I think it's about creating these environments where people feel safe revealing vulnerable aspects of who they are, whether that's them playing a specific character or them as people discussing their art making and their process and how that changed through their loss of vision and what kind of trauma did that induce? What kind of process did that induce? What kind of unexpected humor came out of that? You know, what does it mean for Ryan Knighton, the writer, to be given an assignment to write about a blind person in IKEA? Like, what does that feel like? You know what I mean?
Right.
And for him, I think that those kind of small, very specific assignments were really liberating and helped him find the humor in his writing and to embrace humor and bumping into things and it almost becoming a kind of slapstick that that became his literary voice.
So it sounds like for you, there is not a huge separation between art and craft in doing your work. That, because I mean, the thing that I would think would be more challenging, you're an artist already, you know those things, and that craft could be more challenging, but it sounds like you have very naturally figured out how to be the same artist you were in most ways, and almost always.
Yeah, or I've adjusted my process to accommodate for my lack of peripheral vision, right? So if that means you know, shooting with two cameras and my shooting a camera that's on a tripod that's stationary, that's doing more wide masters of a documentary subject, and having the main cinematographer doing more handheld stuff where they're actually in the space following the character behind the stage, backstage, you know, before the performance, in dark spaces that are hard for me to navigate given my eye condition, just knowing like what are the parameters of what I can do, and then how can the person that I hire counterbalance that and maybe act as an anchor or in some way we're getting the full story from what we're both shooting,
right?
Whether I'm staying wide and getting different angles that then allow us to have cutting options when Kirsten or Mark, the other DPs, are getting close-ups and medium shots of what's happening. And so I don't know, I'm a big believer in delegating, and I'm a big believer in filmmakers not trying to wear 1,000 hats at once, because I think usually what gets left out is the directing of the actors and the emotion, because that's the hardest stuff to talk about, right? It's actually, it's hard to put into words. And so when I went to film school, I felt like everyone tended to focus on the technical stuff because that was like quantifiable and knowable. And nobody talked about emotion or what to say to an actor to get...
you should have learned that while you're doing it, I guess.
Yeah. Well, you know, I read books and took workshops and studied acting for a year just to understand in my body what it felt like to conjure up different experiences to elicit emotion. Whether or not I was any good at it is a different story, but I think I found a new respect for the craft of acting and what it takes for an actor to dig deep down into their emotions in order to render something really powerful on screen. I think I have a deep respect for it. I think it's hard, and I don't think that, I think some people are inherently gifted at it, and it's something that I find quite awe-inspiring to watch. So for me, sometimes it's like, it's having the best seat as an audience member and seeing it first, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And having my head blown away because of what they're doing, that I know that I don't necessarily have the skill set to do.
Well, it's always fascinating. I mean, what I do, I mean, I have a couple thousand of these interviews with everybody, but a lot of actors, certainly, and the range of temperament and what is needed by an actor for directors. And, you know, a lot of times in the same movie, there are two to three actors who are doing very different kind of work.
Yeah.
And it's a fascinating thing, because it's like, you know, and of course, a lot of them are insistent that everybody else is lying or...
Yeah.
Everybody else is getting it wrong or whatever.
Sure, sure.
Because it works for them. And it's like, and then some of them are very philosophical about it, you know, figuring it out. But it's, it's, I'd say almost to a person, having a person who appreciates acting more fully, often an acting or director who was an actor, is this kind of extra benefit because they know what they're going through.
Yeah. I think that that's definitely true. And I think that, just that idea of empathy, of having literally been in that person's shoes with the camera rolling and all of the crew watching, waiting for them, whether or not they are going to deliver so that they can move on to the next setup and make the day, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
All of those other concerns that people have that are outside of the craft of acting. But, you know, I try to let actors take the lead and just let me know how they like to work and what they need from me, like what's helpful for me, you know. And some actors like to rehearse and like to break down a scene and act it out fully and cry in rehearsal. And some people like to just go to the location with you, know where the scene's taking place, know where they're walking, know where this event is gonna happen, know where the exit's gonna be, and they'll come in with their preparation done, and you'll call action, and they'll be brilliant. And that's what that person needed to do. And, and if they're, you know, mind-blowingly great, then, you know, I know that they know how to prepare and that there was something inherently in the script that they connected to and that they understood the character without us having to get into a deep dialogue about it. Right. Where other people, they want that dialogue and they want to pump you for as much information as possible, especially if you've written the script.
Right.
And so, you know, yeah, I try to, I think it's just like, it's having a toolkit. Just like, it, you know, your camera might have 7 lenses.
Right.
And, you know, the 35 might work better than the 50 for a specific kind of shot and, and certain things that you may or may not want within the frame. The actor, you know, some want to talk it through and be and think about the 6-year relationship that they've been in with this other person that they're acting in the scene with. And then other people are gonna go home and study the hell out of the script and break it down themselves and come in just ready to hit it. Yeah. So I try to adjust accordingly.
So you are a subject in your documentary.
I am.
Was that a hard choice to make?
It was a hard choice to make, yeah. I mean, I think the harder choice was not necessarily whether I was gonna be a subject in it, but it was how I was gonna be a subject in it, how prominent I was gonna be in it, where I would appear in it, how my sections would relate to the other characters in the film. So yeah, I mean, it was difficult, but not as difficult as some people think, because I'd actually done personal documentaries before that I think were much more personal and much more raw, and you know, this felt like, you know, a personal, it felt like a personal documentary coming from a very personal place, but then I also thought of it as the launching pad out into engaging with other people and into asking larger questions about the world that that is not necessarily just limited to my story. So, so you know, I feel like,
sorry to interrupt, but did that come as a desire? Was that a step from the short that you found in doing that, that you wanted to explore other specific things, not just expand the number of people and the different number of stories?
You mean the short that I did in relation to this film? Yeah. Or the short? Well, no, the short that I did in relation to this film was always, it was always known that that short was going to be part of the larger feature. Oh. So it was called Persistence of Vision, and it was just John Dugdale's section, who's the photographer.
Right.
And literally, like, I just spent 6 weeks at an artist's residency editing his 3.5-hour interview down to 11 minutes. Figuring out how to tell his story through his photographs and what he said and when people needed moments to pause and just absorb information and just look at the photographs and when did they want to hear more about what went into making the photographs and how he works in terms of his creative process. But I always knew that that was going to be a large part of the larger film, but I liked the way that it stood on its own and just on a lark, just started sending it out to festivals and it started to get in. So it was just interesting to have this separate piece while I was making the feature. I think it was helpful to actually have people react to just that short, and then have them know that a feature was in the works, and if they wanted a way to support that, they could.
But your drive artistically was the same. Was yours just part of the journey, the same journey as the feature ended up being? Yeah?
Well, no. I would actually say that when I made the just the short about John, I was less clear about whether or not I was going to be a character in the film. And that it took me cutting John and Ryan and making a sample tape for different documentary funders before I started to think about using myself potentially as just a framing device, as just I'm a filmmaker with this genetic eye condition, and I have a fear of going totally blind, and like how that might affect my options as a filmmaker. And so I'm gonna confront that fear, and I'm gonna put that at the beginning so that the audience understands why I'm going out and talking to these specific blind and low vision artists about their creative process. Like, I didn't know whether it would go further than that. And then as the edit progressed, it became more clear that that I needed to be more a part of the piece, and that the audience needed a through line and a connective thread, and that I was the connective thread, and that I was the character that was transforming over the length of the film. And so they're getting on the ride with me, and these are people that they're meeting along with me as I'm going on this journey, but then it ends with me, you know, in this section in Berlin, you know what I mean? And I think the film sort of naturally evolves into that section.
So it wasn't a question of fear. It was a question of ultimately that the story, the whole of the film was better off with you as a narrative thread than...
It was a question of like what's best for the film. You know what I mean? And so a lot of times that is surrounding yourself with people that you have a really high respect for, and a total trust in, because you've seen what they have done on other documentaries, right? And so I worked with an incredibly gifted editor who's named Hannah Buck, and she has had a lot of experience working with filmmakers who were characters, sometimes central characters in their own film. So she cut a film called Memories of a Penitent Heart by Cecilia Aldarondo. Well, Cecilia is the principal character, and basically like a detective going through her family history and trying to kind of put together these disparate elements of her family history to figure out how certain things happened the way that they did, right? And so that has an inherent structure and an inherent way of like parsing out information over the course of the film that is the best way to tell the story. So a lot of times it's exploration, it's dialoguing with someone who feels empowered enough to disagree with you and to, have those dialogues and conversations lead to different types of procedures or processes that affect the film. You know what I mean? So I was really adamant about not writing a voiceover and not having a voiceover that felt quote unquote performed. I thought it was Well, I tried it and I hated it. And I think I felt really self-conscious doing it. Mm-hmm. And I think that self-consciousness came out in how I was delivering it. And so people who heard it told me that. So maybe that also reinforced the fact that I shouldn't feel right. the pressure to do it that way. So what we ended up doing was just thinking a lot about like how I was reacting to some of the other participants' stories in the film. Mm-hmm. So, you know, in the film, John, the photographer, talks about this idea of blindness as a state of bliss, as this kind of frozen beauty in his mind, where everyone never ages, and their hair always looks great, and they're always kind of forever preserved
right.
as they were the last time he saw them, right? And so that led to, you know, Hannah asking the question of whether or not that is how I thought about blindness. Mm. And my answer was like, hell no. You know what I mean? Like, I think of blindness as probably the complete opposite. And it's something that I'm like terrified of. Mm. And I'm trying to hold on to as much of the 20% of vision that I have left. And I'm also engaged in looking at medical procedures that can restore vision that I've lost, right? Mm. And so she's like, okay, so then I think this section that comes after John somehow needs to have you saying that. And maybe it's not necessarily you coming out and saying that. And maybe it's a list of questions that we generate that Kirsten, the cinematographer, who's a really close friend of yours, asks you on camera. And then we build your voiceover based on the way that you respond to these questions with an intimate friend in this very conversational way that fits with the rest of the film. Mm. And so that's pretty much like how the voiceover in the film was made. Mm. And I think kind of makes the style feel more cohesive, because it doesn't, it's not jarring or disruptive from the ways that the rest of the characters right. are talking.
It's organic the way that everything else is.
Yeah. And so that was a really important part of the process for me, of just having someone ask hard questions and having to answer them, and then having those questions turn into intimate conversations with a good friend of mine, and preserving that intimacy the same way that I did with the people that I was interviewing, like John and Kayla and Ryan.
Doing what you demanded of others.
Yeah, exactly.
As you should.
Yeah.
You're going to do it.
Exactly.
You're going to do it. Put both feet in.
Totally.
So
full believer in that.
Where did this all start for you? What made you think of the idea of being a filmmaker in the first place? Were you a kid? Were you in high school?
No, I definitely was not one of those like Spielbergian, like Super 8 camera in the backyard, like, you know, directing all of my like 8-year-old friends to like, you know, be in my magnum opus. I dabbled in a lot of different artistic fields. I did a lot of writing in high school, so I took a lot of creative writing classes. I did some acting in some school plays. I was really obsessed with Prince, and I didn't necessarily want to study to become the a hyper-skilled musician that Prince was. Mm-hmm. I wanted to fly away to Paisley Park and be a part of his, queer-friendly, multiracial utopia that existed in my mind from his music and from the people that were in his band. And I just thought it would be really fun to like be in that band. So I took guitar lessons, I took drum lessons for a while, I studied dance at Alvin Ailey for the last semester of high school, because they knew that at that point you would have already gotten into college and that you were less likely to go to class. They thought that they would just give you internships.
Interesting.
And that was a better way to keep people invested. And I think it's true, actually. And so I studied dance, and there was a lot I liked about dance, and there were things that I did not like, and I didn't do well in terms of like memorizing steps and being in coordination with other people. Mm-hmm. In a sense, it's similar to Kayla. Like, I liked the freedom of doing my own thing and feeling the emotions and the rhythm within my body and reacting accordingly. Mm-hmm. But I didn't like the idea of having to be precise on this specific step with 10 other people hitting right. that same step at the same time. So,
a director.
Yeah, exactly. And so all of those things were components of filmmaking, right? Mm-hmm. So I felt like I found this incredible gift of an art form that could utilize music and acting and writing and dance and all of these things that I love within one art form. And so that happened when I was a sophomore in college. Mm-hmm. I started out taking a still photography course, and I built a portfolio from that. And then, and it was actually quite competitive to get into the 16 millimeter film production classes. Like, there were probably three times the amount of applicants that mm-hmm. that then seats that were available in the class. And so mm-hmm. The professor who I'm still incredibly close with actually mm-hmm. liked my portfolio and could tell where I was coming from and accepted me into the class. And she has been a lifelong mentor to me.
And were you fearless or overly ambitious, or was it just a really good fit ultimately?
In the class?
No, the choice to try to be a director and make movies. It was the idea that you were going to meld all those different things that you did experienced into this very challenging choice.
Yeah, no, I think I liked the fact that there were all of these different components to it, and that for me, it kept it from being boring.
Right, but if somebody has to say, you know, like somebody has to say, well, I am arrogant enough to think that I can be the director and tell everybody else what to do.
Yeah. Well, that's interesting, because I think that like my experience was actually very different, in that I was actually very turned off by that idea of like a type A macho guy, and it was usually a guy with a bullhorn, like yelling and telling people what to do.
Right.
Like, that for me was actually kind of repugnant, and I was like, I'm not that guy. And so I think that is like this strange stereotype of what a director is that has been passed down through the decades.
Right.
And for me, what was empowering was seeing this really shy, soft-spoken, quiet woman leading the class with a certain kind of authority, where she didn't need to raise her voice, but we all respected her. And she had her very own unique way of making films on her own. She had her very own unique aesthetics that she was pursuing. She thought of film the way a poet thinks about words or a painter thinks about paint. It wasn't about funneling you into the industry
right.
to make a deal with Netflix. Like, that was not ever part of the conversation. It was like, what do you want to say? what is within you that is unique and specific and that is beating in you that makes you want to pick up this camera? Like, what is that story? Like, here is a place for you to do that. And let's find like the right form for that story. So that was really integral to me to find specific people. And I always gravitated towards people like this first filmmaking professor whose name is Leslie Thornton. And she taught at Brown for 30 years, and she literally just retired like a couple of years ago, and she came to my screening last night. Yeah. And is an amazing woman. And so I feel really blessed that she shattered all of those perceptions of like the fact that you have to be an arrogant Marine style dude to be a director.
So the fact that you had something in you that you wanted to get out was enough to give you the confidence to do the work, to go
for
it.
Yeah, for sure. And I mean, there are definitely stories that I wanted to tell, and that, and there, you know, for me, like, I'm a Black gay filmmaker, and there was specifically a lack of Black gay films that reflected any aspect of my experience, and it just became clear to me that instead of whining about it, I had to be proactive about it, and I had to make the films that I wanted to see, because those films didn't exist and they wouldn't exist unless people like me like stepped up to the plate and actually like figured out how to raise the money and write the scripts and put the actors together and you know, form the crew and you know, engage with the producers and all that that takes. Yeah. So it's a skill set that you build out of necessity, because there's a story that you want to see that's not there. And I think it's the same thing with now with disability and with blindness and with low vision, and that idea that let 25% of the population identifies as having a disability, but there's such a dearth of those stories. And there's such a kind of fear around seeing those disabled characters. Yeah. And I think that it's a self-perpetuating fear that really affects people's lives. And so, you know, again, I try to be proactive about it and make films that lift some stigmas and that, open up newer stories that speak to audiences that are out there but that are not represented on screen, that suddenly feel like, holy shit, like this person got me. They got what I'm going through.
Yeah.
And this is like a gift to me, you know? And so that's a really special thing, to be the person that can give that person that gift of seeing themselves for the first time. Mm. And yeah, and I guess I don't take that lightly. It's like, you know, sometimes people just come up to me and they just cry for 3 minutes because they were so moved by vision portraits and what they saw and have been struggling with their vision their entire life and whether to remain in the closet about their visual impairment for fear that they would lose employment opportunities. Mm. And I think that that's very real. You know, it's very, the unemployment rate within the disabled community is really high because people underestimate what disabled people are capable of doing.
Well, so, and even people who are not challenged that way. I mean, I have two sisters who are in their late 60s.
Yeah.
One of whom has had multiple eye surgeries and one has had just having her first cataract surgery.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, they're retired. They're not looking for work.
Yeah.
But they're also in a place where nobody else is having that conversation. You
sure.
know, you can't, there aren't a lot of other films at least,
yeah.
where you can even experience what other people are going through
yeah.
in that. Because it is scary and it is, you know,
right.
trying to figure out how you feel about yourself and the world in that situation is a challenge, whether you're, you know, trying to thrive and have a work life or whether
yeah.
you're, you know, comfortable and at home.
Yeah.
It's still you, you know,
yeah.
still the world is different.
Right. No, absolutely. Like I said, we all see the world from our own specific, unique vantage point. And yeah, if you have cataracts and you're going to have surgery and your vision is going to change at post-surgery, and God forbid something goes wrong in, you know, the 0.0002% of chances that something might go wrong in that kind of surgery. But, you know, there is always that fear that you're going to see differently, and that's going to affect who you are. And so, yeah.
Well, it's, the things we take for granted in the world.
Yeah, yeah. Just,
you know,
that idea that I can go and that I have, that I'm fully sighted and I can go move around wherever I want, and I can get in a car and I can drive across the country if I feel like it because I have a license. And, you know, all of those things, I think, you know, that the film calls into question. And it helps people realize that, you know, that their experience and their privilege is not universal, you know.
So when you became, once you started making films, did it feel like this is it? This is my thing? This is who I am?
It felt like magic. Really.
That's fantastic.
Yeah. And however you want to quantify that, like, it's just, it, like, I remember, so these are in the days when, you know, you would get a 2.5, like, color reversal roll of film, and you'd send it off to, I think it was Duart Film Lab in New York, and they would process it, and it would come back, and, you know, it come back into my university mailbox, and I couldn't wait to, like, you know, unpack the box and, like, string it up on the projector and project it on the wall and see what happened. Like, did I do the exposure right? Like, did the actors do what I thought they did? Was the framing the way that I thought it was going to be? So, you know, yeah, I just thought, like, the capturing of life and the movement of light through celluloid was magic. It just had a magical power for me that was the start of a lifelong love affair, for sure.
And the success of Brother to Brother and the awards and all the things around that, did that feel just like a step in the journey? Did it feel like some sort of arrival? Did it...
No, I think it felt more like a step on the journey. You know, it felt like validation. It felt like a feather in the cap, for sure, of, you know, being selected for this, you know, this incredibly prestigious film festival, right? Mm-hmm. You're like one of 12 films that's selected for this dramatic competition at Sundance, right? Mm-hmm. And so yeah, it felt great to be part of that pool of filmmakers. But then I also feel like that environment, you know, it has its pros and its cons. I'm not gonna say that it was all magic, you know what I mean? Like, some of that conjures up, like, a competitive edge with other people, and you know, you're like, well, wait, why is that person walking out of here with 4 William Morris agents and and a manager and a high-powered lawyer? Like, where's my William Morris agent, you know?
I pointed out to people that, shockingly to me even, that at Sundance, the director winner of the prize at the end, of all of them, only Ava has ever gotten a studio movie made.
Is that right?
Yeah. She's the only one who's ever gotten a studio movie. I mean, some of them worked more and some of them worked less, but like, it's a weird stat. You would think it would be, you know, very different.
Yeah. Yeah. And I don't know what that says about studio aesthetics and people's ability to navigate those aesthetics and turn them into something that they're interested in doing. I think it probably has more to say about that, you know, like, what does it mean to have $100 million budget and be responsible for that and deliver a story that has to recoup that kind of investment and still feel passionate about it. And so I think maybe Ava is one of the few people that can have that budget and swing for the fences and find her passion within that very broad-based story.
Interesting.
But I don't think it. I don't think that's like a natural fit.
Right.
You know.
Well, just as though we've had all the conversations about, you know, indie filmmakers moving up into the ranks of studios.
And yeah. Like, yeah.
And then you realize that it's, you know, it's hard. It's there's the door is not. Forget, the door is closed in many ways.
Oh yeah,
and
for
one
sure.
of them is new young filmmakers are not. You know, it's not always four William Morris agents or whatever. It's
yeah, yeah. I mean, particularly if you're a person of color or a woman, mm-hmm. or queer, mm-hmm. or disabled, to be frank,
yeah.
you know, and to be like totally straight up, because people tend to identify with and connect with people that are just like them. And usually the larger percentage of people at those agencies are straight white men.
And well, as you say, the money, they see the money as being a very specific narrow path.
Yeah.
And for filmmakers who are looking to be artists first,
yeah.
it's that path is not, you know, the, even if they're not just seeing color and gender and everything else.
Yeah.
They're, you know,
they're seeing
they have
money.
A narrow idea of where the money is.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I think that that's definitely true. And, you know, I mean, I think about, you know, someone like Ryan Coogler going from Fruitvale Station to Black Panther, and that being a huge leap, but maybe not such a huge leap in terms of his passion and his interests
right.
as a filmmaker, and
we had a passion for genre.
Yeah,
you know, and Creed, and also in the middle, so it was you know,
right.
Yeah,
yeah. So you know, a steady climb, and slowly getting more and more resources, and a return on that Creed investment, and so people trust you with more money if you've actually. Made the money back from the previous movie that that you made. So,
I was having a conversation with somebody. It's the 20th anniversary of The Matrix.
Oh yeah.
And how Warner Brothers had no idea what it was when they were releasing it the first time.
Uh-huh.
They thought it did not realize it was kind of this game changing thing.
Yeah.
And they said, "Well, I haven't seen other Wachowski movies." And I was like, "Well, they did." Now I'm going to forget the name. They did the movie with. Joe Pantoliano and Jennifer Tilly and Gina Gershon.
Bound.
Right. Yeah. That was their proof that they could make a studio movie.
Right.
And the budget was, you know, $22 million or whatever.
Yeah.
This tiny little thing.
Right.
Comparatively, but that was what they needed to do to get the $150 million.
Yeah.
To make The Matrix.
Yeah.
Which they really wanted to make, but they were scared of them.
Sure.
You know?
That's, yeah. I mean, I think people need that. Those safety nets of like, you know, this person did it before and generated X amount of dollars. And then that, you know, that keeps people from getting fired in the studio world, which, and it's a complex world. This whole division between art and commerce and how they balance each other. I don't think that there are easy answers, you know. I think that
so has your journey been the journey you have chosen along the way? I mean, I'm sure there are disappointments here and there and things like that, but are we seeing your presentation of throughout all of this work of who you are and the
core? Yeah. I mean, I've been blessed to always have Final Cut on my films. And so I think the higher the budgets go, the more people you are responsible to, right? And so I don't think people are just cutting Ava a $100 million check and walking away.
No.
I think there are some executives that are going to be all up in the editing room
mm-hmm.
talking about how something's playing to X, Y, and Z demographic. And I don't know if Ava had Final Cut on that $100 million film,
right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And maybe she's okay with that. That would be a bitter pill for me to swallow. If
so whether it was a $50 million film or a $100 million film or a $20 million film, $10 million film,
yeah.
You need your... That's
I'd
part
rather
of your
have. I'd probably rather have less money and Final Cut than than 10 times the money and somebody taking a film away from me and recutting it and having my name on it and it have having nothing to do with what I was passionate about for when I started making it. Yeah. For me, that's like one of the worst things that could ever happen. You know, I don't know how you bounce back from that. So,
yeah. And you can't say anything either, because otherwise you die.
Right.
They all try to kill you.
Everybody's got like an NDA that you had to sign in order to get the job.
But I mean, even like the most generally, filmmakers who have said anything bad about the process when their film is coming out, studios just stay away. The money all stays away.
Yeah.
Because they're scared at that point. And even if everybody, even if the person's completely right,
sure,
they freak out.
Yeah, it's bad marketing.
Yeah, exactly.
For the film, yeah. No, and that's, I mean, I think that, you know, you get in to that situation with your eyes fully open, knowing like what are the best moves to make in that situation, and what compromises are you willing to make? Is it enough to get 80% of the story the way that you wanted it, and you know, to have a young black girl be the central character traveling through space to find her father, you know, whatever it is, it's like, maybe I got enough through that system that I feel good, and I'm going to move on to the next thing. And maybe I didn't win all of the little battles, but you know, I feel like I accomplished enough of what I set out to accomplish. And, you know, part of working in the studio system is the art of compromise.
Well, I took enormous crap for saying it in public, but when that movie did not do business, my thing was, the thing that will show that there's progress being made in terms of the industry is if, coming off something that did not work financially, she gets the next big movie.
Right.
Because that's what white guys have been doing all this time. You know,
sure.
They don't get 100 choices. I think sometimes that gets exaggerated. Yeah. And like, you know, they have endless chances.
Yeah, but they get a lot.
You get to make another movie.
Sure.
You don't get stopped because one failed.
Yeah, yeah. You don't go directly to movie jail.
And she indeed did get another. She has another project at Warner Brothers. Yeah. $100+ million. So.
Sure.
Are you the kind of person who looks for it and goes, 5 years from now, I want to be doing X, Y, or Z? Or are you going to look for the next piece of inspiration? Or
I usually take it step by step and project by project. And they usually have to be like things that I have a burning desire to tell. And so I usually don't try to have some grand scheme, because I just think life is so unpredictable that it's going to throw you so many curveballs that you never knew were coming, that I think it's good to have goals. And I think, you know, I definitely have scripts that I have written and things that other people have written that I'm interested in. And so, you know, I think that each film that you make that gets out of the world, that gets out into the world and gets some level of either critical or commercial success, you know, gives you a leg up on getting the next thing off the ground. So, you know, that's my hope, just to keep working and keep making films that I'm super passionate about.
It's a challenge.
It is a challenge.
Every one of these things, you know, it's like making the $100 million movie is also a challenge.
Yeah.
Different challenge.
Yeah, yeah.
But they're all, making art is, you know, you're not painting a wall or painting a canvas. That's, you know.
Yes.
In a collaborative, financially expensive medium.
Yeah.
It takes years of your life.
Yeah. But I also think that like certain stories don't need $100 million.
Right.
And certain stories can be told for $2,000 and should be told for $2,000. And that those can be powerful and resonant to people that you never imagined would be able to connect with that story. And so, for me, just the barometers of success are not necessarily financially driven, you know? Like like a lot of filmmakers, I teach, right? And so I'm fortunate enough to have the safety net of an academic teaching salary that gives me the luxury to not have to hustle for the next gig to put food on the table, or, you know, do a car commercial that I don't give a fuck about to make X million dollars that I can then put into my indie film. Uh-huh. It just, that's never been a part of my equation. And I don't feel like I could even fake the passion that is necessary to be within that world. And I know that about myself. And so I don't go there, right? Where other people are like, commercials are great. I get to play with all these toys. I get to practice my craft. Like, I get to set up some shots. They give me like a huge ass paycheck. My family is, you know, the kids are going to college. I bought the house on the hill. Like, I'm not mad at commercials. Where I'm a little bit like, I don't know if I really want to put my passion behind convincing people that this product is going to make their life better when it probably won't. Yeah. You know, I don't know if that needs to be where my energy gets pulled. So, it's not like those drop out of the sky and fall into right. your lap really easily. Like, I know people that, you know, work their asses off and put together all kinds of lookbooks and take all kinds of meetings to get that one commercial that's gonna pay well for the year. And there's 40 other directors that want that one commercial too. So it's not like, so at least I know that, like, I'm not interested in that.
Right.
I'm not gonna throw my hat into a ring that is just not, it's not my jam, you know? It's like, I'm not gonna like fake it for you to pull in a paycheck.
Right.
And so, you know, I think that there was a survey with all of the filmmakers that were at BAM Cinema Fest,
mm-hmm.
where Vision Portraits played, and I think there was just like a one question survey from IndieWire, which was, how do you survive financially being an independent filmmaker? And I think like 85% of the people were like, we work in academia.
Yeah.
Like, we teach.
Well, Sales even uses his salary to, you know, make his movies.
Yeah.
That's part of his thing.
Oh, like, yeah, for sure.
He you know, saves it up over a few years and then goes out and makes another movie.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah,
so
yeah.
It's a good company.
Yeah, yeah.
you and Deborah Granick and Todd Solondz, and there are a whole lot of.
Yeah.
Really fine filmmakers.
Yeah, for sure. You know, Deborah actually just moderated a Q&A of mine in New York last weekend. And so we were at Sundance in 2004 together with the tiny micro budget films. Hers was Down to the Bone. Mine was Brother to Brother. You know, Garden State was in competition with us. Maria Full of Grace was in competition with us.
Josh also, pretty aggressive. I don't know whether he's teaching at this point, but.
You know, he's done some big like Netflix movies.
Yeah.
He did a small indie.
I think they kind of wore him down after
with,
a while.
With Rachel Weisz.
Right.
And I think he does do some teaching at Columbia. But
he sticks to his guns on, you know, where his, he has not done junk.
Yeah.
You know, he really is committed to it.
Yeah, no, he has done things that I think he's been really passionate about. And so, you know, I don't think it's an either or, but I do think that, if you are generating the projects and you're not in it to make the money, that it's going to be harder for you to raise the budgets, and you're going to have to be really smart and crafty about how you make the film and who you make the film with and who's, you know, who's part of your team, who's going to get you across the finish line, who's going to make it the best film possible. And those are decisions that got, you know, that get made at the under $500,000 level, and then they get made at the $100 million level as well. I don't think that those decisions change. I mean, maybe more people are in the departments under that department head that you've chosen, and you've given the freedom to that person to fill that department with people that they trust, but it's still delegating responsibility and, you know, figuring out what is the financially responsible number to make this movie for that actually does recoup for the investors. And
of course, we don't have the government in America that that inspires that, you know,
hello,
makes it work it for every other country and like in the civilized world.
Yeah, all of
you
that.
You talk to European filmmakers and they're what about a budget?
Yeah, they're like, oh, like the Finnish government just gave me, you know, $500,000 to make my obscure animation film. Like, what? Why, don't they do that here? And you're like, no.
No.
They don't, actually.
Well, someday, we'll keep our fingers crossed. They'll come back in fashion.
Yeah. Yes, let's keep our fingers crossed because... because culture is a powerful thing and has the capacity to change people's lives and impact their experiences and the ways that the world functions. And I think we need a government that, that understands that and gets that and supports that. So we'll see when that happens.
We'll see when that happens. First, we have to get past the fascism part.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you very much for your time.
You're welcome. It was my pleasure.
Thanks for coming out.
Yes, no problem.